Hi and welcome to The Breakdown again, and we're here at Hallcroft, a brilliant fishery where there's some fantastic silverfish leagues. Now, a brilliant tactic here is the short feeder line. So I'm going to get into the detail and talk to you all about this winning method. So what I want to really get into today is having a look at a short feeder line. Now, a short feeder line, if you'd have asked me about this 5 years ago, I would have said, what is this? Why are you even talking about it? Just fish a pole, you know, it's not the done thing. Why would I fish such a short feeder line? Well, the introduction of feeder only matches has made this short line a really important tool, but it's also taught me that actually, it can be a better method, it can be a winning method on any method matches. It's not like you have to only do it in a feeder match. So I want to sort of look at why that line is so good and what advantage the feeder gives you to that line and why it could be really good to add it into your armory. So today I've come back to the same peg that I recently completed the league in. We have a winter pairs series here at Hallcroft with Feeder Masters. It's a fantastic league. Me and partner Will Freeman actually came second in the league, and I won the final match from this peg on moat. And a really good run late on that short line catapulted my weight from being sort of like a good weight to an exceptional weight that actually won on the day. And I haven't always had that short line right. I haven't always had the elements of it right. I've almost disregarded it. I've almost given it like a, oh yeah, you just lob in there at the end. It needs more than that. It needs a little bit of thought and it needs a little bit of consideration. Now, what do I mean by a short line? Well, every venue is going to be different. Every venue is going to have different set of circumstances. So you may go to a venue where almost literally off the platform, it's the same depth all the way out. It's very soft. Your short line could even be in the edge, in the margin in those circumstances. But today I've got what a little bit more of a traditional style approach to a lake, whereby it's probably about two and a half feet in front of me here, and then it just goes down slowly and drops down to 5-6 foot about 6 meters out. Now after that, it just very, very slowly gets a little tiny bit deeper as you go out, and the bottom gets softer and softer as you go into the middle of the lake. So I'm looking to fish where the bottom is still firm, where the bottom is still hard. I don't want to be fishing where, you know, I'm onto that soft, silty bottom, because I'm going to be doing that further out in the lake. I'm looking to fish somewhere where the bottom is firm, and that's because I want to be quite aggressive here with the feed. When you're fishing on a soft, silty bottom, the trouble with that is if you feed too much bait, you get a lot of indications, the fish dig around in the silt and it's no good. Whereas if I'm coming back onto a firmer area on the bottom where I can fish, I can be a little bit more aggressive, and these bigger fish, bonus bream, big perch, things like that in a silver match, not to mention carp. If you're fishing a carp match as well, they come in the latter stages of the day and they come to that short area. We know that from pole fishing. So I also want to touch on, why would I use a feeder rather than a pole? So obviously a feeder only match, that goes without saying, but just look at the conditions here today. It's quite a naughty wind. It's at me, it's slightly across me, there's quite a strong tow, and it means that when I'm fishing with a float, it'd be quite difficult to hold it still. Whereas with a little feeder, I can plop it in super accurate and wait for a positive bite. Everything becomes cleaner, the fish is definitely on, and you get it in. When you're fishing with a pole, often, unless the conditions are perfect, you end up foul looking a few fish, misjudging what's going on, and you can catch really quickly on a feeder. So I've actually added it to a lot of my any method matches as well, and that's something that we'll sort of touch on a little bit more as the session goes on. So let's get on the box and I'm going to show you what to look for. So the first thing you need to do is establish where you want to fish this line. Now, what I'm always looking for is a bit of a transition between the two different types and makeup of the bottom. I'm looking for that area where the sort of stone and gravel area just starts to turn to silt. I'm not actually that fussy whether it's very, very slightly in the silt or very, very slightly onto the gravel. And I know that sounds a bit strange, but where the silt starts, it's not going to be very thick. It's not going to be thick silt. If you imagine in a sort of a bold environment, the silt begins to get thicker and thicker as you go further out. But as long as I can find that sort of transitional area, that's what I'm looking for. Now, you need a heavy bomb to do this. I've got an ounce on here today. I won't fish with an ounce when we're fishing, but I need a nice heavy bomb to read what's going on. All right, and I'm looking for that area. Now, what you need to do is you need to swing your bomb out, your lead out, okay? And I'm just gonna have a little reach out there because I've plumbed up and found this area. Now, because I've reached out a little bit, as I very, very slowly try to bring the rod, I can actually feel that the plummet is moving just, but it's quite a smooth movement, okay? If I pull this a little bit further, I can now, there it is, it's starting to bounce. So my bomb is now starting to bounce on much firmer area on the bottom, okay? It even then just got stuck behind a little stone as I've dragged it in, which means that I've found that little transitional area. Now, it's very, very easy to find once you've done it a few times. So, for example, if I just swing this out here to where my clip is, I'm gonna take my clip off, go another half a meter further, all right? And if I do this again, I'm very confident now that my bomb is gonna stick into a bit of silt, which tells me I'm on that transitional area. So I'll just swing that out again, let that hit the bottom, and then just slowly, not a big sweep, just very, very slowly put the rod under tension. And you can see there, look at my rod bending right round and it's just starting to move. Look how, and it's smooth. I can feel it smooth. Then I get to about here, which is about half a meter back from where I was. And there you go, it starts to bounce again. So it's obvious there that I'm on that little transitional area. And if I chuck this bomb in a little bit closer than that, I should be straight away on the firm. So if I chuck that out to the clip, take my clip off, take about a meter back in. This is just a check in my own mind that I found that area. All right, so I'm just gonna swing that bomb back out again. So now when that bomb hits the bottom, I'm expecting it not to grip into any silt, it just to bounce straight away. Look at it, bouncing over the stones. Just bounces over the stones. So I found that area which transitions between the soft silt and the firm gravel, and I'm gonna look to fish right on that sort of boundary there. Now, what's very, very important is you must mark this distance. You must use your measuring sticks. Don't think it's gonna be exactly 5 meters or exactly 6 meters. It might be 5.5 meters or something like that. And I'm gonna show you on the sticks exactly how I do that, because it's absolutely crucial that you've got the right line at all times. Okay, so I've hooked the swivel up right next to the stick there. Now my sticks are at 3 meters, so I'm just gonna go around here and I've clipped it up exactly on that little border that we talked about. Look, you can see it stopped just before it got back to 6 meters. So what I'm gonna do is I've got these little toggles on the bottom and I'm just gonna slide one along and try and get that at exactly the right spot. So I know if something happens, there you go, look. So I now know if something happens, if I need to take my clip off or anything like that, I can just quickly mark my sticks back up to the exact point. So it's not about, well, I'll just fish at 6 meters. No, I've spent the time to find that exact point. So that's exactly where I'm gonna fish. Very, very important. So now we know where to fish, let's have a little run through of the setup that we're going to use. It's really straightforward, as you can imagine. It doesn't need to be overly complicated or anything like that when I'm fishing at this sort of distance. First of all, the reel, it's a 520 extremity. Surprise, surprise. You can see this one's still got the ground bait on from the weekend. It's very, very hard wearing. I've absolutely hammered these reels. I'm still on my original ones. Brilliant, brilliant for feeder fishing. So I'm always gonna go with that. Some people like a really small reel when they're fishing short. Not for me. I like a 520 for all my feeder fishing. I like that size of reel. It gives me power and control over what I'm doing. So that's why I go for it. On the main line, I've got 018 sinking feeder mono on the reel, okay? And I'm gonna look at the little bit of a rig in a minute, but that's the setup down at the reel. That is sat on a 10-foot Superior SL. It's absolutely crucial that you have a rod that's very soft and forgiving when you're fishing this short line. What you don't wanna be doing is hooking a big fish, hooking that big bonus fishing, because you're fishing short. As the bite goes and you pick up, you need the forgiveness in the rod. And a 10-foot SL gives me that. It's nice and short. It gives me complete control over what I'm doing. So if it's a 2-ounce roach or a 15-pound carp, I know I can land it on this rod at short range. It's amazing, actually, the number of times I've had carp and I haven't even needed to take the clip off because the rod is so forgiving on the initial bites that you quickly get the fish under control. With a stiffer rod, I know that I'd have to give it some line because there'd just be too much resistance there for the fish. But I will always look to this rod, even if I was fishing a method, that is the rod I would go for until it gets, say, the height of summer and the water's really warmed up, and then I'm just gonna go for a normal 10-foot Superior. So let's go down to the rig, because the rig's quite interesting. It's very simple and it's quite interesting. So on this, having this 018 main line is lovely, but I don't like the feeder to be on such thin line. My problem with the feeder being on thin line is when I load the feeder and grate it against my bowl, and maybe the swivel slides up and down, I just feel that damage can occur and maybe you might crack off even for a little underarm 6-meter chuck. So I can't afford to risk that. So what I do is I've actually got some 022 here, AccuPower, all right? And I've actually tied on just over a meter in length. I've just done a little three-turn water knot. It's got a nice little three-turn water knot, and then I've got this length, you can see here, of 022 AccuPower. And what I've done is I've slid on one of our stops, one of our rubber stops, just slid one onto the line, okay? Now, in the Feeder Master's pairs, I can't have a hook length any shorter than 50 centimeters. So I've actually tied a little knot in that line just to make sure my rubber stop doesn't go anywhere. However, these rubber stops are really stiff and they don't slide very easily. So when I'm allowed to fish really short hook lengths and I don't know what sort of length, I end up putting two of these stops on the line and I just slide them up and down to suit what length hook length I want. And you come all the way down and I've got a little loop in the 022. And then I've put a 6-inch hook length on. And I'm a massive fan of doing this. It makes it really quick and easy for me to change my hook length. Even though I've got 022 here, this hook length is 010. So I'm 022 to 010. And for a lot of people, they think it must make a big difference. Well, for the last 3 years, I've been using a rig very similar to this. And I've always had this thick line going right the way down, and it's made no difference to my catches whatsoever. I believe that this rig limits tangles. I don't get any problems with tangles and things like that. So it's got lots of advantages as a rig. Very, very easy to make up, very, very easy to use, and you can change your hook length to anything you want. Now, see here, I've got a little feeder hanging on the end. It's an ICM in 12 gram. This is what I'll be fishing with today, but I'm going to talk a little bit about the feeders in a bit. But that's the general setup for the rig, very easy to use, and we'll talk about the finer details of the hook and the feeder once we get fishing. So we're going to have a little look at the baits I'm using in a bit, but first of all I want to talk about when to feed this line, because there's lots of different things you can consider when you want to feed this line, but it has to be mainly when you want to go on it. Now, at Hallcroft, when I've been fishing the silver matches, it's not a line I'm going to be going on at the early part of the match. It's primarily for like an hour, maybe an hour and a half to go. That's the sort of time I'm going to be looking to use this short line. Now, I'm a big believer on commercials that I don't really want to feed a line well in advance of going on it. I believe that fish on commercials, when you choose to fish in an area, you can tee them up pretty close to the time. So I don't want to be feeding this line at the start. Some people choose to do it, maybe they're right, but for me, I like to feed it probably about 30 minutes or so before I'm going to go on it. That just gives it enough time to settle down. So in the recent match, it was 2 hours from the end of the day, and I didn't feed a load of bait there. All right, again, I don't see the point in piling in a load of bait there. I'm trying to use the time of day to actually go and fish the line. So it doesn't make sense to put loads of bait in. So when we look at the baits, we'll sort of go through in a bit detail, but I'm going to show you what I did now. Literally, I've got like a little pinch of Joker here, and I've just popped that into my ground bait, and then a little pinch of maggots, pop that onto the Joker. I've got a 4-square, 20 gram wire cage, so not a great big feeder. I'm just going to nip that bit of Joker and few maggots into the feeder, not very hard. Look, just squeezed in there like that, and then a nice little lob onto that short line. Okay, put my rod out in front of me, let it hit the bottom. Once it's on the bottom, little shake, and then I can wind it in. All right, now I'm only going to do 3 of them. Remember, that's a 4-square feeder. It's not a big feeder at all. Little tiny blob of Joker, probably 5 or 6 maggots, something like that. Not many maggots. Just as an odd sort of hook sample, really. Look, little squeeze, have a bit of bait sticking out. This isn't about chucking it in clean. Remember, we're just trying to attract the fish in for the time being. Pop that in again. Let it get to the bottom. Couple of little pulls, and it empties out nice and clean, all right? Just 3, that's all we're gonna do. We're not gonna put loads of bait in. Again, I see some people putting 6 or 7 in. Look, maybe there's a place for that in certain situations, but for me, this time of year, don't forget, it's still cold. You know, the fish aren't looking for loads of bait. They're just looking for a bit of a trigger to start them off. So that's what I'm doing here effectively. I'm just sort of like saying, listen, lads, we're ready to have a feed now. And that's what we're doing. So I've done that. I'm going to wait 30 minutes before I go on it. Make a note of the time when you're fishing. 30 minutes or so and we go on it. But what we'll do is we'll have a little look at my bait selection and have mixed my bait up while we're waiting. Okay, so let's look at the bait table for here at Hallcroft. Remember, on a short feeder line at another venue, your bait will be reflective of the sort of target fishing that you're doing. But on this league at Hallcroft, which is what today's really all about, it's very simple, okay? I tend to get a small pack of Joker. I'm not going to feed lots of Joker, so I just keep it here in a little tub in the paper. I like to put the paper in the tub, just keeps it nice and clean, and I can just pick bits out when I need it. And got a little bit of hook bloodworm that I cut with my match pack, because we're allowed bloodworm and Joker on this league. Now, really, this doesn't play a huge part on this close line, because I like to try and catch on more, I don't want to say traditional baits, but let's call them traditional baits for what we are, maggots and maybe pinkies. Now, the reason being, I'm looking for quality, all right? Bloodworm can be great for attracting quality fish, but it can also get you a few pesky fish as well, like little tiny perch and stuff like that. And I just feel the introduction of maggots and pinkies can help you a lot. Now, I like live maggots and pinkies, particularly in winter. I think they're quite attractive. So I tend to bring 1/2 pint of red maggots and 1/2 pint of red and fluoro pinkies, and that's my live baits. Sometimes I've tried using casters, maybe sometimes I haven't. To be honest, I just like to keep it dead simple with a few live maggots and live pinkies. I think that keeps my selection dead easy. Now, ground bait, you'll be absolutely flabbergasted to hear, is F1 Dark. Remember my rules when I'm talking about this. F1 Dark, I always like to mix it with Thatchers, but it's winter, I need it fine, I need it weak, so I've got 4 parts F1 Dark to 1 part Thatchers. This is my mix here, nice and damp. I've mixed it nice and damp, so it's just gonna be able to nip in my feeder and slowly break down. And you can see in this tub here, there's a very odd Joker, all right, in the ground bait. Not a lot of Joker, hardly any Joker at all, okay? Just an odd Joker showing there in my ground bait. And this is going to be my fishing mix, all right? This will be the mix that I put in the feeder, probably 9 out of 10 casts. And then I've just got a little tub here, and this has got sort of 4 times the amount of joker. You can see the actual ground bait is a lot richer. It's got a lot more joker in it. And I just use this every time I think, ooh, the bite's dying a little bit. I just nip into this tub and I put a slightly more joker rich mix in there to bring some fish back. So on the venue you're going to, it could be chopped worms, it could be a few extra casters, could be some micro pellets, whatever that may be. But the principles of what I've done there remain the same. A mix with hardly anything in, and then a little rich mix just so I can use it as a top up as and when I need it. Dead simple bait selection for really what should be simple fishing. So how do you go about starting this line off? So we've left it now for about 30 minutes, and I want to start by, I don't want to go over the top, I don't want to go straight in with that slightly bigger feeder. So I've put the smaller feeder on, but I'm going to cast quite regularly. What I don't want to do is I don't want to be sort of like just chucking it in and waiting 10 minutes for a bite. I want to be quite proactive to start with, to try to generate a little bit of action, a little bit of interest in that line. You can often tell straight away with this line if the fish are there. So I tend to give it like 15 minutes. So 15 minutes, maybe casting in every 2-3 minutes. There you go, that's my first chuck, first bite. Classic of a lot of the fish that are there, these little chunky perch. But I'll sort of give it 15 minutes for it to happen, all right? So if after sort of 15 minutes of casting in regularly, I'm not getting any bites or there's no indications from fish, I'd probably put that larger feeder on, maybe put a couple of quick feederfuls in, and then just give it a little bit longer to settle down. Because what you've got to remember is the fish won't have to naturally be there on this line. It's not a line where we're sort of going to attract them there, because if they don't want to be there, they're not going to be there. They need to want to sort of be at that distance at that time of day. So that's the sort of thing that I'm looking for, to be honest. So I'm just going to put this small feeder on. And what you've got to remember is the matches that I've been fishing here at the moment, you're not fishing for a big weight. If you catch 10 pound, then that's a really sort of good day. Both your partners catch 10 pound, you're doing well. So when you can drop on this line and get bites from fish like that, look, little skimmer. First one was a little perch, but I got a bite really quickly that time as well, which is a good sign. That perch before was on my actual first cast of the day there. You can already see that you could build a weight quite quickly here just with sort of little skimmers, perch, roach. You know, you're not looking for a huge weight as it was, because it's a silverfish match. However, on the other side, there's also a chance of an odd bonus fish here. So in the recent match, I weighed 21 pound and I caught 2 or 3 really nice skimmers, like 2-3 pound fish. And they make all the difference. So if you can catch a couple of them mixed in with those smaller fish, obviously you're going to be onto a sort of like a winning combination. Now, I'm just going to get my rod rest in the right place. But you can see how quickly I got that bite. Little indication there straight away. This is a great sign. There's some signs of fish now straight away. Yep, little taps, little knocks. Brilliant to see. Brilliant to see that there's some indications in the peg and some signs that there's a few fish there. And it's one of those lines that I just feel will build on me in this last hour. I'm not expecting to lob in there straight away and catch a 2-pounder. I'm almost feeling like a little bit of activity, me going in and out all the time, is going to make the difference. And I'm just using that mix that's got a very odd joker in, and I've just dropped a couple of pinkies in it the last couple of chucks as well, just for that bit of liveliness. Look, little bite there again. Brilliant fishing, really enjoyable fishing. Little chunky perch. So this is why I think you have to be busy. I don't think you can sort of sit and be slack. I'm just literally 2 or 3 pinkies in there. Feeder slid up the line, let's grab that back down. Just nip them in, look. little loaded feeder. Don't squeeze it in too hard. Got a maggot on the hook, not got bloodworm on. I'm just trying to be a little bit more positive. You can see how nice that little feeder goes in with the little underarm cast that I'm doing there. We'll talk about that cast in a minute, but we'll just... This is all about sort of just getting settled into a bit of a rhythm. I'm not using my stopwatch or anything. I'm just getting a vibe for what's going on at the moment. That's what I really enjoy about it there. Look, that's a better fish. Look how quickly the bites are coming. That's crazy, isn't it? You know, it just shows how quickly you can potentially put a weight together on this line if the fish are there. Look, oh, really nice perch. You know, these are the fish that you don't seem to catch out there, like, you know, nice chunky perch like that. They're the ones that can make a big difference in silverfish matches. And, you know, a few of those in the net to go with your, you know, your little skimmers and what have you that you maybe have caught elsewhere, they can make a big difference. Lovely fishing. I love the busyness of it. And I hope you can see there, just in that first little bit, how quick it is. You know, how quick it is even compared with like a float or something like that. If I was float fishing, I don't think I'd have caught those, you know, the fish as quick as that. Obviously your rig's got to go in and settle down and what have you. So you can see it's not sort of almost traditional feeder fishing. I'm not putting my feeder on the rest or anything like that. I'm trying to get straight back in as quickly as possible. Pop it down. Just let it hit the bottom. Just dragging my feeder. I've got a nice soft tip in on my little slidey rest, so I can just position my rod straight away. Look at it, indication straight away. Is that on? Oh, just pulled out. Got a bit keen. You've got to wait for those bites to develop. But you can see already I'm excited by this line. It's, you know, when I'm talking about that first 15 minutes, if you like, you can already see in that sort of first 5 minutes there what a difference it is. You know, there's bites there, there's activity there. This is definitely going to be a line that's going to throw me up some fish today, I can tell already. So it's great to see, and that's what I'm talking about. It's the game changing line, because you can catch so fast when the fish are there. Getting little taps on the tip now all the time. Look at that. What a little tiny taps. I'm just waiting for something just to develop a little bit more positively than that. I think there's a lot of fish there, pecking at my maggot, picking it up. Not that time, little perch and things like that. Right, yeah, look, maggots obliterated there. So there's a lot of little fish there. I'm gonna have to work and be busy at it. I think this is a really good time as well to talk you through how I'm casting out and how I'm trying to fish this line. This little feeder on here, gotta remember, don't wanna be crashing my feeder in. So if I tried to overhead cast it 6 meters, it would be difficult to do. Underarm casting is something that I was absolutely rubbish at 5 years ago. Hopeless, couldn't do it for love nor money. Went out and had a little practice, and now it's something that I add into my fishing all the time because it's very easy to do. So what I do is I load my feeder up, and I personally, I just hold my hook length so the feeder is sort of hanging to the side, and I sweep the rod round, and I love having it on a clip. The clip just helps me almost plop it in there. Without having a clip on, I'm trying to sort of grab for the line and stop it. But by having the clip on, you can see how easy and how quiet my feeder goes in. Because if you think about it, your feeder's not coming from sort of like a big height. Because you're sweeping it in low, you're actually bringing the feeder in much lower. So when you hit the clip, it's going in so much quieter. It's a technique that I used in the Feeder Masters final, and I actually fished 12 meters, so double this length. But I was never bothered at all by sort of like underarm casting up to 12 meters. It's something that I think is a very important thing to learn. Let's have a little look at the feeder selection. Don't forget, on this league that I'm fishing, you can't use method feeders or things like that. But it does remind me that there is an advantage to having longer hook lengths, because the fish definitely seem to watch that hook bait coming down. So I still think there's a place for a traditional feeder, even on venues where method is allowed. Maybe sometimes we get a little bit caught up on method feeder fishing. So just bear that in mind, and bear in mind what I'm going to show you now. So there's three feeders for me that are always on my side tray when I'm fishing this line. Okay, first of all, I need my feeders to be nice and light. I don't want a big heavy feeder. Don't forget, I'm just underarm casting it 6 meters out. I'm not casting a long way. So the first one is the 4 square 20 gram with an odd little bit of joker on there after our initial feed. This is only used for feeding the peg, okay? I might use this again to top it up if I feel it needs a second hit of bait, but it's very unlikely. The chances are that's just for that initial feed. Then I've got the two smaller versions. First of all, I've got a 3 square, which is in 15 gram. This is a great feeder and often a good feeder to kick the peg off with because I want to try and suck some fish in early doors, or maybe if I feel like the peg's dwindling away from me, I might put this 3 square feeder on and just up the amount of bait a little bit. But for most of the fishing, it's going to be done with the little ICM 12 grammer. I'm going to be casting really regularly, like 2-3 4-minute casts. I don't want to be putting loads of bait in. I want a nice quiet little entry, and these ICMs give me exactly that. So I've just put one of the little swivel stems in there that I cut down nice and neatly. You can see that's a beautiful, beautiful, neat little feeder just to be lobbing in close. There's something really nice about fishing with a soft rod and little feeders. Very satisfying, nice way of fishing. It's something that I do a lot, and this is going to work really well for you. Now, you might notice that both my feeders have got like a little link on there. I'm a big fan of a link when I'm fishing for silverfish. I like the fact that my rig has a little bit of movement. I'm not into anything too complicated. This one's got doubled up power gum on it. This one's got doubled up 10-pound line. Personally, that's all I need, and I usually make it about 1.5 to 2 inches long. It just gives a little bit of movement on the bite, so the tip starts to go and the fish almost hooks itself before it feels the feeder. That's why I like a little link on, and that's why I've got one on my two little feeders here. So a really nice simple little feeder selection, but it means I can work the peg and keep on top of it at all times. So I've enjoyed a really sort of good start to this. Well, not really a start. These short feeder sessions don't tend to be play a long part in my match, but you know, we're sort of like nearly an hour into it now, and I've had quite a few of these bonus skimmers. I've had a lot of roach and perch, but it seems like in the last 20 minutes, these skimmers have come in and they've pushed the roach and perch out. You're not bagging on them, but if you're getting like one every sort of like 3 or 4 minutes, that's a really good return on a hard silverfish day. Sometimes you sort of go in and catch 2 or 3 really quickly as well, which is great, to be honest. But it definitely seems like those smaller fish have backed off. But I tend to find what happens is a few fish come into your peg, be that skimmers or maybe a carp, and you go in and you don't get many indications, but when it goes round just like that, you know, it's a nice skimmer. And then all of a sudden, the small fish come back and you sort of go through like these little phases of activity where you think, oh, there's too many small fish here, I can't. You almost have to like ride through them and then you sort of get those runs of better fish. At the moment, or in the last sort of like say 10-15 minutes, all the small fish indications have stopped. Sometimes it just takes those skimmers to back off and then the small fish will come back, but it's such an enjoyable way of fishing, especially when it's skimmers like that. You know, I've been able to put a weight together today really quickly. You know, we're well over 5 pound already in this hour, which is brilliant. Like I said, on a normal day, this isn't genuinely, it's not like a 5 hour method. You'd have to be on a right flyer to catch on it all day. You need to think about this happening in the last hour and a half. That's when this method comes into its own, like today. So, you know, I'm getting indications there that looks to me like there's a few skimmers there. Really pleased about that. Got to be a little bit more patient when those skimmers turn up. Obviously, I've talked about casting in regularly. That is important on this line. You know, I've got a little feeder on. I certainly wouldn't wait more than, say, 3 or 4 minutes. I'm not sort of looking at chucking it out and sitting here and waiting 10 minutes. It's not how I want to fish this line today. Oh, there you go. So there's definitely some better skimmers in the peg right now. Definitely some better skimmers in the peg. Just try and keep the rod nice and low, or that's a better perch, that one. It just seems like a few better fish in the peg rather than the small fish that we caught earlier. So you can see what a great method it is and what a great method it's been today already. You know, if you use this in a match, or even if you just want to go and have a day's pleasure fishing at it, if you follow these sort of techniques, you're going to catch a lot of fish. You're going to put more fish in your net. I've just stuck with that single maggot. Been using that single maggot, and I've just been getting an odd pinky, literally one or two. I think that's really important as well. It's maybe in the summer you can up it a bit, but you don't want to be feeding loads of bait. You end up with too much bait in your peg down there, and it's going to be chaos. You're going to get lots of indications and foul-looked fish. You know, you're casting in all the time. You've got a little feeder on. It's a beautiful way of fishing. That was the first sort of perch or roach I'd had for a while, so it might be that I sort of go back on a run of small fish again. But brilliant, brilliant fishing. And you can see I'm holding the rod. I've not got the rod in the rod rest. I've got it, you know, in the butt rest. I've just got it on the rest in front of me, and I'm trying to keep the tip nice and slack, and I'm looking for the indications and bites to develop nicely. That's what I'm looking for. They're the signs that I'm looking for. A little indication there, a little liner. Just trying to read it. It's hard to sort of, you're waiting for it to, a positive pull, little taps there. Could be a little perch maybe. The more you fish it, the better you get at reading it, you see. The better you become at reading what fish is what, and, you know, waiting for, make sure the fish on. Could be another perch, this, I'm not 100% sure. Yeah, another chunky perch. You haven't had a perch for about 20 minutes, two in two chucks. That's how this line goes. You know, maybe that last skimmer that we caught was just almost like one too many for them, and they've just backed off. And then what will happen is, I expect I'll probably catch 3 or 4 of these perch maybe, or maybe that'll just be it. And it'll go back to skimmers again. Maybe then a bigger skimmer will come into the peg. That's the beauty of this line and the style of fishing. You've got to take everything that comes. Don't be disappointed when a fish comes. Just try to read it and get the best from it. That's the most important thing to do. So, look, I hope you've enjoyed it. I'm going to catch a few more. And we'll see what we end up with. Well, there you go. That surprised me, I've got to be honest. Lots of sort of smaller skimmers mixed in with odd bigger ones in there as well. That is literally just over 2 hours on that short line today. An astonishing catch. And it just shows what that line is actually capable of. If I was fishing a float there at that distance, I'd be absolutely delighted with this sort of catch in that time. Brilliant, brilliant fishing. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope you take something from it. Give it a go on your next outing.